Hello, my name is Kyle, and welcome to episode 8 of Video Bootcamp, all about the entry-level production process. We've already covered the production process in an earlier Video Bootcamp episode, going over the basics, the general gist of the production process, but I want to go over it once again. For entry-level production and make some suggestions for what your process should look like at this level. So the first stage of the production process, pre-production. I want you to perform a quick and easy pre-production process at this stage. Getting new video and filmmakers to do proper pre-production is difficult. It's a habit that needs to be formed eventually. But at this stage, I want you to do basic pre-production. So what I mean by that is enough to plan out your shoot, but not enough to stifle motivation. So what I mean is I want you to write out a basic script and maybe even map out a basic storyboard for your projects. In a perfect world, I'd have you be writing proper scripts, planning out every shot in your production. But at this stage, it's much better to get you to do it and do it enough to build a habit than have it be too much of a task. And you all just want to go out and shoot. Nobody wants to do pre-production, but at this stage, do some basic script writing, maybe some basic storyboards, just to get that habit going. And now on to entry level production. I already talked about some production tips in the previous video about making the most out of the gear that you have, but I want to reiterate some points here. First of all, keep the camera on the tripod. It's hard to stabilize video. Even experienced people have a hard time, so keep it on the tripod for now. Another one is make simple and quick videos. Make easy videos that you can just go out, shoot, and get that ball rolling. Make a bunch of projects and get in the habit and build your passion without investing a bunch of time and effort into making larger videos. But don't forget the design elements. So every time you make a new project, try incorporating line into your image, or try playing with the 180 degree rule, maybe bending it a little bit. Try something new every time, and perhaps with each video, have an idea and then challenge yourself in a way. So it's like, okay, I'm not very good at creating balanced images. So in this project, I'm gonna focus really hard on each shot having a super balanced image. Or maybe you struggle with getting good clean audio. So this project, you're gonna focus really hard on audio. So each project that you make, it's not gonna take a very long time, and you're gonna focus so hard on that one thing. You're gonna learn from your mistakes. And that's the next tip, is learn from your mistakes. So you're making all these great videos, you're having a lot of fun with it, and you're making mistakes, which is good. Everybody makes mistakes. If you aren't making mistakes, you are, you just don't know. So critically rewatch your work. But the last tip for production is just to have fun with it. Go out with your friends, plan out really fun videos, just make some stuff. None of the things that you're producing right now, aside from a few gold nuggets, you're not gonna use for your portfolio or your demo reel in the future. You're gonna get much, much better. That doesn't mean you shouldn't be proud of what you make now, but trust me, you're gonna get better. You're gonna improve your craft, and just go out and have fun with it. Don't worry so much about making the best video ever. And with post-production, I would actually like to go up in my desk, because I'm gonna start talking about file management and some basic video editors. So we're gonna go right up there just in a sec. What's going on? It's Kyle from 2 days later. I'm up in my studio at my desk in my bedroom, and I want to introduce you to post-production. So what do you do after you have shot everything, you've got offset, and you're coming back home and you got all your files, right? So the first thing you do is file management. This is very important, because after you do maybe like one or two projects, it might not be that big of a deal to have like files strewn everywhere, but the further you go along, it'll be worth it, because you're gonna get so much footage. I have like 8 terabytes filled. I have 2 different hard drives when they both have 8 terabytes, and they're filling up, and just organizing it, seriously, you're gonna thank me later. Okay, so I'm gonna show you what my YouTube folder looks like. So right on here, it's one of my hard drives, YouTube. right? And we got a bunch of folders here. Most of these are kind of useless right now. So let's jump into the video bootcamp folder. So I have video bootcamp right at the top and I have them organized by videos. So I have episode 5 here. I always create a new folder for the camera footage. So for me, I'm shooting on my X-T3. So I name it Fuji right here. Osmo is a separate folder here. And then my audio recorder also is a separate folder. So Tascam right there. So all the footage folders are right here. And then all the project folders are in the general video folder. Very, very important. The first thing you should do is dump your footage onto your computer and always make sure it's backed up. So hard drives fail. Generally, I don't delete footage off SD cards unless I have it on the computer already. That's just me being paranoid, but sometimes that's not possible. Putting it on the computer and then taking the SD card out, and then you can format it and all that stuff. So this is what my YouTube folders generally look like per episode. So that's episode 5. Episode 6 is empty because there's nothing here. But if I were to do episode 6, I'd create a folder for Fuji for the camera footage and Tascam right there. So really simple stuff. Something that I've been doing recently is the footage that I shoot out of the camera is 200 megabits per second. So it just takes up a crap ton of space. So I've been re-rendering that footage in HD 20 megabits per second after I'm done with the episode and export it. Yes, that means that some footage isn't gonna look as good. I'm gonna keep the most important, good looking demo reel type stuff in that original file format. So the way I do that is I will go into the folder. These are the mobs and I'll re-render them as MP4s and then I'll copy them over to this, which is basically the archive, my YouTube folder. Let's see how big my YouTube folder is here. This is basically my archive for YouTube. So like all of my files are in here. So this is 2019, 2018. These are all the videos for 2020. And then Video Bootcamp is right here. So for episode 4, here's all the files. I mean, you can see that episode 4 was quite involved. There's a crap ton of files. I have Fuji 1, Fuji 2, Fuji 3, Tascam, Thor the Dutch Angle, just a bunch of different stuff. So you can see that like it becomes really important. So turns out my archive for YouTube is almost 2 terabytes, 1.84 terabytes. It would be like triple that if I wasn't re-rendering clips. So let's go back to this folder. So that's with per episode, but you're gonna have stuff that transcends each episode. So like graphics or thumbnails or like my outro. So like I have a separate folder for outro here. Sound effects, I have a whole folder for sound effects that I have gotten over the over my YouTube career. I have some pictures, not a whole lot of pictures in here. Cookie Monster. I don't remember why Cookie Monster's on there. Motion graphics, so anything I do in After Effects is a separate folder. Graphics, so like my YouTube stuff. This is the end slide for my outro. This is my avatar. Any like channel arts, graphics. And then I also have a separate folder for bloopers because I like to do yearly bloopers. And then final videos is a separate folder for me. So whenever I export a YouTube video, I always export it to a different folder. So final videos, this is what I am uploading. So that way I have a nice, easy to access backup. So like something happens to my channel, I'll have all of those videos easy to backup. Not all the metadata, like the titles and descriptions, but at least the videos are there. So it's nice and easy for me to look to. And then I wanna talk about, This is not just for YouTube. A lot of you are gonna be looking to make money off of your videography or filmmaking, do commercial work. And the way I organize my professional folder is actually different. I've already archived a little bit for my professional work, but essentially what happens for professional work, I separate the video files, the project files, and the final videos. So archive is where I put the final videos. I've already archived this, so trust me, I get more work than this. So these are all the archives. These are the final videos. So let's look at this bad boy. So there's one final in there. It depends, like, and I always render out different versions. So this one, you can see that this project, I had to redo it quite a few times. So that's archive media. So there's the media for all of it. It's organized in a very similar fashion to the YouTube. It depends on the camera or any pictures or video. Basically, any of the media files go in media. And then projects are a separate folder. So all the project files, usually it's just my one Premiere Pro project, depending. And then for music, I have a separate thing for music and invoices, and I have some presets here. So that's how I organize it. It doesn't matter how you organize it, as long as it will upscale. So like the more video files and the more that you work, you can continue to expand and organize in that same fashion, because I've probably tried 4 or 5 different organization ways, and I'm a data hoarder, so I have files from like 2005. It's ridiculous. I have so many files just like hoarded, essentially. Looking back in like 10 years, looking back in these files and the folders, it's gonna be a lot easier if you set a system up right away. So that's that for file management. If you wanna get an external hard drive, like your computer doesn't have a whole lot of memory on itself, like if you have a laptop, get an external hard drive, 1 terabyte, it's like 60, 70 bucks. So that is the first step, file management. You got all your files on the computer, you've started organizing them. So let's get into editing. So I suggested DaVinci Resolve in the last one, and let's just show you how to put media in DaVinci Resolve, put it in a timeline, and then export it. So I've opened up DaVinci Resolve. This is the first thing that shows up. So I'm gonna hit new project. We're gonna go if I can spell right. Okay. And we're actually gonna use video that I haven't touched yet. So I'm gonna go and find my clips. You got YouTube, marathon content. Okay, so I added it into DaVinci and it asked me to change the project settings, because the project is at a different frame rate. So frame rates are important, but if you shoot in the frame rate, DaVinci's gonna ask you to change it. So just change it. Okay, so we got our clips right here and we can add them to the timeline. It's running a little bit slow because I'm doing my screen capture software at the same time, but if you press I, it's like, okay, this is where I want the clip to start. And then you press O, that's where you want it to end. You can add it right to your timeline here. And I'm gonna switch over to edit, so I have more control per clip. So this is before the 10K and everything. You could throw it in there. It's like, ah, look at that, great. So we have two clips in here. It's not anything special. In fact, I didn't put any effort into editing this, considering I don't know DaVinci Resolve super well. I mainly use Premiere and After Effects. I'm mostly looking to use DaVinci Resolve for color grading, because I hear that it actually is pretty versatile for color grading. I don't really have any use for editing or general editing for DaVinci Resolve, so I'd highly recommend looking up some tutorials, because I guarantee there are people that know Resolve much, much better than me. But this will be the general process for any video editor. You're gonna put your clips in there, you're gonna add them to the timeline, and then you're gonna render it. So let's render it real quick here. Okay, so we want to render it. We're gonna go to deliver here. We're gonna go dummy video 10K, and we're gonna find a place to save it. We got the YouTube folder, final videos, dummy video 10K. Format, MP4 is the standard, so that's like any computer can play an MP4, and the codec should be H.264. And then here's the resolution of the video that I had, 60 frames per second. Add it to render queue, and let's render it. Okay, our video has finished rendering. Now, if you're sitting there, it's like, okay, the video, but what if I want music in my videos, but I don't want to spend anything? There is this great thing called royalty-free music. So I'm gonna go into my browser. I'm gonna go royalty-free music. And literally there's gonna be a ton of websites that show up, and they're gonna have royalty-free music. We got Bensound, we got Free Music Archive. Incompetech is a very popular one. In fact, if you go on Incompetech and you listen to some of the music, you're gonna start recognizing it because everybody uses Kevin MacLeod's Incompetech. Like, if you need free music. The only thing with using free music, of course there's gonna be a catch, is that some of them with the usage rights, you might not be able to make money off of them, or you're gonna have to credit them. Before you just go crazy downloading music for your videos, make sure to look up the usage rights. For me, I pay for a music library and I get really good music and I can use them commercially for whatever I want. And it's like $15 a month. So if you really wanna spend that much at this point, you can, and you'll get some awesome, incredible music. But if you don't wanna spend that money, royalty-free music is the way to go. Literally just search it in Google, royalty-free music. Just make sure to check out the usage rights for it. Copyright is a big thing and you do not wanna mess with copyright. So the very final thing is that you have to upload it somewhere. And the most popular thing is YouTube for video sharing. You can make it unlisted if it's for a client and you just need to see them. I use Google Drive a lot for clients. I'm gonna start transitioning to Dropbox for sharing those videos. But in general, that's the rundown of post-production, organizing your files, editing, some basic editing, again with Resolve. Look up a tutorial for someone. I'm sure I'm not gonna be putting any tutorials for DaVinci Resolve because I won't be using it for all of its features. But for you, it's free. Go out there, use it. It's very powerful. I just don't know too much about it at this point. Royalty-free music and then upload it somewhere. So I'm gonna jump back downstairs to finish off this video. All right, we are back on set, and that was post-production, and that's what the production process for entry-level video makers should look like. I asked on Instagram when the last time you got a haircut, because currently most of us are in quarantine, and if you're like me, I'm turning into a caveman, essentially. So I asked, how long has it been since you got a haircut? And I got some interesting responses. The first of which, Andrea said, almost exactly a year. Brian, I mean, define haircut. Brian, I know that you shave your head, okay? That's a haircut. You're cutting your hair. Don't get me on the semantics. Josh Winiarski says, shaved my head like 3 days ago. And Josh, thank you so much for showing me. I'm actually gonna get a trimmer in about a week. You taught me to fully charge the trimmer before you go at your hair. Because otherwise you might have a half shaved head. Holly says October 25th, so another long period. 9 weeks. From Amanda, Sam says last August, so another long time. Jake said, bro, like 3 or 4 months for me now, and I hate it. I'm with Jake. I like the untrimmed look. I've probably done my hair, like put hair product in my hair a total of 3 times in the last 6 weeks. So I've really embraced it. I mean, I've been wearing a ton of hats and I've just embraced it, but I'm really excited to get back to the clean cut look because this is getting out of hand. And then Johnny says, 8 weeks, I look like Moses. And if I had decent facial hair, I feel like I'd be getting the Moses look eventually. So maybe in the next video, I'll be nice and shaved. We'll see how that all pans out. But I hope all of you are doing great. It's a weird time if you're watching this during the whole, you know, virus thing. So I hope you guys are working on yourselves or just hanging out. I'm wishing the best for all of you. If you want to get a possible shout out in the future, go ahead and follow me on Instagram. It's right here. I post on my story whenever I'm shooting down on my set. And then you can answer the question or just reply. The bar for entry for shout outs is pretty low right now. So if you want to be featured on a future famous YouTuber's channel, then get on the ground floor. At least that's how the people down at Wall Street do it. So that's it for me today. If you have anything to add about the whole quarantine hair thing, or if you have things to add about the production process, the entry level, or if you have some questions, drop it in the comments section down below. Make sure to roast me for everything that I say and all my opinions. And subscribe if you want more video bootcamp videos just like this. And I hope you all have a fantastic rest of your day, and I'll see you in the next one.